We will explore free fall today, and we are going to look first at the first instance where we came to know that objects that are rolling down inclined planes accelerate. That is starting with Galileo's inclined plane experiment. So Galileo discovered by using different inclinations of these planes with let us say the situation A having a lesser incline than situation B. When you roll down an object down these inclined planes, he found out that the object would accelerate faster down this inclined plane than down this inclined plane. And he knew that it accelerates because the distances covered by the object in the same time interval. So these indicate 1 second time interval, let's say. The fact that they cover greater distances in the same interval of time seem to indicate that the objects are becoming faster and faster. So in terms of what we already know about accelerated motion of objects, we can therefore conclude that what Galileo was observing, witnessing, was actually accelerated motion. Now,
sir,
the question is whether this acceleration was uniform or not. Yes, question. Somebody had something to say.
No, sir, you explain this and then I'll ask after that.
Sorry?
You first cover this uniform and non-uniform. And then
I'm just going to give you the information about this and then start off with free fall. So, but you tell me, what do you want to say?
Sir, so you said that what Galileo was this thing observing was acceleration.
Yeah.
But wasn't acceleration already introduced at that time? He said the balls sped up as it was going down.
Yeah, which means.
So wasn't that acceleration?
Correct.
He like indirectly?
Yeah, indirectly.
Define acceleration.
Yes.
Yeah.
But I think at that point of time, they didn't have this information that acceleration could be therefore calculated as the rate of change of velocity. I think,
okay.
I don't remember seeing anywhere that Galileo came across that concept, but he figured out that it was speeding up and that it was probably also speeding up at a regular rate. Yes, somebody else wanted to say something.
Yeah. So the inclined plane B, the object that is going, like that is coming down, will it have more acceleration than inclined plane A?
Precisely. Correct. That's
right. Yeah.
Because you can immediately by inductive reasoning, you can say that if the slope were lesser than this, so let's say that you had a very tiny slope like that, okay, and let's say you have an exaggerated slope, let us say something like that, right, you can immediately see that the rate at which the object accelerates in this and the rate at which object accelerates in that are definitely going to be different. So you can therefore say that when you go from a lesser slope to a greater slope, the acceleration will increase of the object.
But why?
That's what we are coming to. Okay. Why we will come to in the next chapter. But we can live with the observation for the time being that they do accelerate.
For now, it's a God-given truth.
For now, it is the God-given truth. Thank you.
Yeah.
Because of gravity now.
Yeah, of course.
But gravity is acting. See, the weight doesn't change at the ball.
Is it? See, it's like,
it's a like, God-given truth for now. You can't argue with that.
It's a valid question to say that, but the weight of the object doesn't change. Then why is it becoming faster and faster? So
I think that
we will come to that. Let's not jump the gun now, but it's a valid question. I acknowledge that it's a very good question too. So, okay, so let us just work with the basics for the time being. Let us say, for example, that the acceleration had a uniform value of 2 meters per second per second. Okay, taking this inclined plane, the situation A, let us say that when you make some observations,
That's the acceleration.
Yeah. The acceleration for this situation, or let me put it over here. The acceleration for this situation is 2 meters per second. And I hope that it will be all right from here onwards for me to write 2 meters per second.
Yeah.
Does anybody
have... Yeah, sir. And what's the blue box there?
I'll tell you. I haven't yet come to that. Okay. Is that okay with everybody?
Sir, how? What? No, that's not okay with me.
Wait,
sir, how
see.
How did you get to know that?
Dividing a number is basically multiplying it by inverse, right?
I don't think she's asking that. She's saying, how do you know it's 2 meters per second? Two.
Exactly.
She's objecting to this. I'm saying, let it be. Sometimes when we solve...
Damper.
Yeah, you assume that it is two.
Thought experiment.
Oh, okay.
2 meters per second, How much it actually is depends upon the slope, depends upon the surfaces, depends upon how you are conducting the experiment and how you are measuring it.
Okay. Sir, but that would mean that the acceleration here is uniform. And we don't know if it's uniform or not.
Yeah, let us assume uniform.
And so you're telling me to take it as a God-given truth.
Yeah, for the time being. We will arrive much later to the fact that it is indeed uniform and how it is uniform. It's not an easy to conduct that. Okay.
So we can...
Yes?
So you take the distance traveled.
Yeah.
And you compare it with the second distance traveled.
Yeah.
Right? So you get some constant, right? So then you take the second distance traveled and divide by the second third distance traveled. Then you get another number.
You will get average velocities. You see, it's continuing to accelerate in between each interval.
You subtract the distance covered.
Distance. You are
trying to say it's like adding vectors.
It's not like adding vectors, but if you know the distance that it is covering, what he's saying is, I know that it took 1 second to cover this distance. So if I can measure this distance by performing an experiment, then I can tell you what is the average velocity of this object between this and this. If I compare that with the average velocity between this and this position, then I should be able to tell you what is the average acceleration.
Like comparing the velocities between the periods of the...
Yeah, but I'm saying that easier said than done. That's not an easy experiment to perform. But anyway, we
will... Exactly. How will you stop the ball or measure it and all that?
Sir, acceleration is velocity by time, right?
Change in velocity by time taken.
Delta V.
So you know average velocity here, you know average velocity here. Subtract the two, divide it by the time interval of one. Then you will get the average. Okay. So anyway...
prove whether it's uniform and non-uniform also.
It will prove it that it is uniform or not uniform.
Yeah.
Okay. Somebody was asking me, how will you do it? Well, you can't do it with the kind of equipment that Galileo had. That would be very highly unreliable. But with modern photography, multiple exposure photography and moving cameras and then very accurate measurement of time, it will be possible to do this. But it would be rather indirect. It wouldn't be any direct way of doing it. But it can be done. That's not a problem. You can also simulate it. You can simulate it by using software that can allow you to do it. But then people won't be very happy with the software simulation because most of the data you would give. So there is some mystery about this, let us say, at this level. But let us say that we are starting with the assumption that the average velocity is average acceleration is 2 meters per second per second. And I'm saying meters per second square, I'm going to start using for accelerations units from now on. I hope people don't mind. It means meters per second per second. Okay. So at time t is equal to 0 second, so I'm just going to chart out what is going to happen to the velocity as time proceeds. Okay. So at the beginning, the velocity of the object will be zero. At the end of 1 second, what will be the velocity of the object?
Two meters per second.
2 meters per second, right? I shouldn't actually, okay. Time in seconds, velocity in meters per second. Okay. Should always mention units when we are doing this.
So can you just make that more clear?
Okay. All right. So let us chart out the time in seconds and the velocity in meters per second for this object. So I said in time t is equal to 0 second, velocity was also 0. The time t is equal to 1 second, velocity will become 2 meters per second.
Yeah, yeah.
At 2 seconds, the velocity will become 4 meters per second. At 3 meters, 6 meters per second. At 4 seconds, 8 meters per second.
8 meters per second.
And of course, so on and so forth. Don't become boring. So what this tells us is that if you want to know the velocity of an object at any time interval, okay,
you need to double it.
That is only in this case. That is only in this case. Because the acceleration here happens to be 2 meters per second, right?
You have to multiply it by time.
Ratio.
Let us say that in this case it was 3 meters per second square acceleration.
Then you triple it.
Then it will be 0, 0. I'm using the same table here, so don't get confused.
1, 3, 1, 3, 1, 2, 6, 3, 9.
So you basically have to multiply it by the time.
Exactly. So that's the relationship that I wanted you people to see. That is,
you make a ratio in each.
Yeah. So if you want to know the velocity of an object at any time interval, for an object that is having uniform acceleration, then the velocity will always be equal to acceleration multiplied by the time. So this relationship is what I wanted you people to see.
Okay.
Okay. If you know, I'm repeating this, if you know that the acceleration of an object is uniform, right, then you can find out the final velocity of an object which is undergoing that acceleration at any time interval. So after 100 seconds, so in this case you can also say, well, how do I know what is the velocity at time 100 seconds later? Well, it's simple, multiply 100 by the acceleration.
2 into 100,
so it will be an incredible 200 meters per second.
Yes.
Okay,
sir.
And in this case, if you want to know what is the velocity at 100 second for the object which is undergoing acceleration at the rate of 3 meters per second square, it will be 300 meters per second.
Yeah.
Now question. Somebody had a question.
Yeah, I have a question. Sir, you said velocity is equal to acceleration is equal to time.
Into time.
Yeah.
Yeah, but what if you don't know whether the acceleration is
uniform,
same or not?
Yeah.
Uniform or not.
So we have to assume. That is why I said it's a God-given thing. At the moment, see, in physics, obviously, okay, let me not start with physics. Let me start with real life. Obviously, in real life, you're not going to be able to say whether an object that is undergoing acceleration has uniform acceleration or not, because there are so many factors that concern it. Wind velocities, thickness of the atmosphere, you know, friction value,
air resistance,
so many complicated things are there. So what we do is that when we try to understand something, when we try to make a principle from something, when there are so many complexities involved, we will not be able to succeed, we will fail. Okay, so what we do in physics is reduce it to the simplest factors that are possible. So what we say is that forget about all the air resistance and all those things. Only consider a situation in which the acceleration is uniform. Is it like this in real life? Well, possibly not. Then why are we talking about this when it's not something that happens in real life? Because if you take all the complexities in real life into account, we will never arrive at some kind of a principle, some kind of a backbone on which to develop things. So for the time being, set aside the complexities, look at it in a very simple form. It is reductionist, it is simplistic, but at least it tells us something for certainty. And that is the beauty of...
It's like that box you made.
Yes, exactly.
That mystery
now you
box.
Understand why I made the box. The box I made precisely for that reason is that don't get complicated with the actual things that happen in the environment around you, because that will complicate matters. We will come to that. We will build the complexity slowly in such a way that at a later stage, perhaps some of you will become engineers, then you will deal with the full complexity of it. You have to, after all, for example, make a building that will not fall. You will have to make a bridge that will not collapse, right? You have to make things that actually work because people will pay money and buy it, right? So at that stage, you cannot avoid the complexities. But until that happens, let us do the building blocks in a simple manner. So that is why you say, take acceleration as being uniform, and then let us see what happens. Okay, so is this understood? Because it's a very...
Yes, sir.
It's an often asked question by students in physics. You know, it seems like it's all make-believe. There is nothing real about the physics that we do. No, it's not like that. The reason why we do that is because we don't want to deal with the complexity, because the complexity is too hard to account for at the moment. Let us build it with simple building blocks, and we will introduce the complexities slowly. All right? So what we can now say is that we have an equation to figure out for an uniformly accelerating object, given a time interval, what will be its final velocity. All you need to do is multiply the time with the acceleration and Bob's your uncle.